Good morning and welcome to WEP On Air. My name is Michelle Ponta and I'm the Senior Advisor of Communications here at KAUST. My guest today is Dirk Ahlborn, the CEO of Hyperloop Transportation Technologies. Welcome to KAUST and thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
So our first question, I just want to know, what exactly is Hyperloop and why are people saying this is going to revolutionize the way we travel?
So imagine a capsule filled with people or freight hovering inside a tube and moving really, really fast from one point to the other. So basically you take all the air out of this tube so that the capsule can travel almost at the speed of sound, okay, with very little energy. So it doesn't encounter any resistance, very similar to an airplane that goes into high altitudes. And I think the main advantages are two. One is the speed, right? Speed of sound, I think is pretty cool. But the other part is that it actually has very low operational cost and therefore can be profitable. So if you look around the world, there's not really any rail line or metro line that's profitable. They're all losing money. And we can build something that actually generates income and therefore solve big issues and the budgets that are right now going into public transportation can go into education, for example, right? And you will have a better transportation system, not only from time perspectives, but also from the passenger experience. We have the chance of building public transportation the way we would do it in 2017, so.
One of the things I found interesting about the project is that it doesn't have a big environmental impact. Tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah, so it's completely powered by alternative energy. You have solar panels along the track, on top of the tubes. You use wind and kinetic energy to produce almost as much energy or even more than you're using. It depends a little bit where you're building, of course, but in California right now, just with solar, we're capable with the latest solar technologies to recover the complete energy cost.
Okay. Where is this going to be developed? Which countries have picked it up already, and where will we first see this happening?
So the biggest issues when you do a project like this is actually not the technology. The technology exists, it's out there, it has been there for quite some time. It's about putting them all together, of course, and making sure that it's not getting too expensive. But the big issue is regulation. So you need to work with governments all around the world. And we have been working with many. We just signed an agreement with Abu Dhabi, for example, in the Emirates. We signed an agreement last year with Slovakia, so we're now looking at the land for a local project in Bratislava first. We have another project in California, so there's a lot of different places around the world that we're looking into developing it, because we need these governments around the world to help us and support us in getting these regulations out.
Okay. One of the other questions I had was, you were eventually, well, from the plans I saw, were thinking to do something from LA to San Francisco. Is that still kind of in the works?
So, doesn't work? Okay, awesome. So, LA to San Francisco was what was originally proposed by Elon Musk, as an example. There's a bullet train, which they're building. It's kind of like the slowest high-speed train that would ever exist, and it's very expensive. It's over $68 billion, so the idea was, let's build something that makes actually sense. We're the center of technology, we can do better. Now, LA to San Francisco would be awesome, but of course it's very complicated because there's a lot of politics involved. So there are other routes right now around the world that are definitely a little bit easier to implement because they have problems right now. So, definitely the Middle East, China, Asia, Indonesia, India are the prime target markets.
Okay. Has there been any reluctance for you to, or any pushback from other companies, like traditional transportation companies, who are worried that Hyperloop is going to make them obsolete?
No, actually, we have a very unique model in our company. We collaborate, so we work with a lot of companies. Most of the team members are actually working in exchange for stock options, so it's a very unique model that we're using, and so we're collaborating with a lot of transportation companies. I think that today they realize, they know that it's not possible to really stop progress. It's better to be part of it. And we're not a direct competitor, so we're a technology company. We build technologies and then help these transportation companies to implement them. Mm-hmm. So it's from, of course, a hyperloop, so the capsule inside a tube is one, but a lot of the passenger experience, monetization technologies, for example, are able to be implemented into existing modes of transportation. So we work with Deutsche Bahn, for example, which is the largest rail company in Europe. And we have a project that we call Innovation Train, where we put these technologies into a new train. So I think that collaboration is very important.
Okay. Were there any challenges in getting this idea off the ground and into where it is today?
Yeah, of course. I mean, so, you know, everybody, when they talk about the Hyperloop, they talk about Elon Musk, mm-hmm. And him bringing up the idea. But in real, it has been around for quite some time. So I think the first time that what I could find was actually Jules Verne's son, who wrote in a book about traveling inside a tube. One of the first attempts was done in 1870 in New York. So there was a pneumatic subway that they built, and they actually built part of the track, a station, and they moved these capsules around. The first patent for a train inside a vacuum was done in 1904. There was two projects in America in the 60s. There was a project in the 90s in Switzerland. And all of these failed because, well, the early ones definitely technology. But later on, it was more, I think, an issue of support, governmental support. You know, normally these kind of things are done by a government, not by a company. So we realized we had to build this in a different way. We had to be more than a company. We had to be a movement. So that's exactly why we have a very unique way of working. We have a very large community, so we're using crowdsourcing with this community. It's over 50,000 people. We have team members all around the globe. There are now a lot of other companies trying to do the same thing. There's Elon Musk is supporting the community with a SpaceX competition. So by now it is a movement, and that's really what was needed.
Tell me a little bit about the crowdsourcing aspect of it. That's kind of unique, an aspect that you're doing with this.
So it's mostly about asking questions. And I believe that it's 2017, so we have the chance to redesign the way we do public transportation. And in order to completely redesign, you almost have to forget everything or question everything. So that's exactly what we do. We ask our community, do we need a ticket, for example? And not only do we need a paper ticket, but figuring out what really is the business model, right? Because someone decided in the 1800s that the ticket was the best business model, but at the end, maybe it's more about the time that you spent during transportation. So I believe that you can create a much better passenger experience, you can make more money through other means, as an example. Or if I look at the cost of our system and I look at where we spend money, pylons is a big, big element. And so if I ask you, here are 200 pylons, they're yours. What are you gonna do with them? And it's just asking this question, right? Because normally when they build bridges or a viaduct, well, you have to build these pylons. Of course, they have to be there, they hold up the structure, but nobody ever questions that. Nobody ever says, well, what else can you do? So it's that, and then of course, you know, a community comes to us with ideas. Even the naysayers for me are part of our community because, you know, when they say, well, this is never gonna work because of, that's actually good for us because then we can take a look and see if they're right, if we have thought about this. So, you know, we have people that are helping us and giving us their contacts. I have met presidents of countries because people reached out to me through our community and said, hey, I want you to meet the president, so why don't you come visit? And so it's really, you know, it's a different way of working. You know, if you put people together and everybody's passionate and everybody knows something and has their specialties, their skill sets, you can build an amazing company. I mean, we have from the saxophone player from Pink Floyd that's part of our team, to sculptures, to sound specialists, to psychologists, to, of course, aerospace engineers that have brought the Mars rover on Mars. Really all kinds of profiles in the company.
That's interesting. It's like your consultant board is made out of thousands and thousands of people.
Yeah, I mean, you know, everybody of us knows something very, very well. Mostly it's based on our passions that we have. And so if I can tell you, look, we want to do this better. What ideas do you have? What can you bring? That opens up a lot of opportunities.
Do you find that the crowdsourcing is helping people really accept that this Hyperloop thing is going to be a way of the future, and they feel that they are now a part of it?
So I think that there's it's a little bit split, right? So we started 3 years ago. We were the first company working on this. We made this into a movement. Now there are other companies that are using traditional ways. And sometimes I feel that especially the press seems to value money maybe a little bit more than it values brain power. I mean, you know, so there's one competitor in specifically who has raised a lot of money and also spent a lot of money. I mean, we have raised it as well, but we're using it in a different way. And for us, the knowledge of our team members is much more important. I mean, we have Leibold Vacuum, for example, as part of our team. There's inventors of the vacuum pump. There's the guys that are responsible for the vacuum at the CERN Hadron Collider. You can't buy that experience. So, you know, having these guys and having them really involved and having them at your fingertip, that's invaluable. And I think much more important than having millions. And you can build a better company by actually thinking about how you use money better. If you have money, I think a lot of times you're not really solving the problems. You go the easy way. So crowdsourcing has allowed us to, or being open at the end, because crowdsourcing is always a little bit difficult to explain, but being open and letting people join the team and letting people know that they can participate has really helped us to spread the word and to get ideas in. I mean, our levitation technology came out of the community, for example.
It's very interesting. So how long has this idea been around for when you got involved? When did you first decide, okay, Hyperloop, we're gonna do this?
So Elon presented it beginning of August of 2013, and 2 weeks later, basically, we were working on it. So when I heard that he didn't have the time to work on it, he wanted someone else to do it because he was too busy with Tesla and SpaceX, I reached out. We asked for permission to put it onto this new platform that we had created. And that's it. And I guess the rest is history. I mean, by, I think, end of October, the company then was incorporated. In the meantime, we had asked people, should we be doing this? And interestingly enough, I mean, on the platform, there were two options. Yes, you should be doing this, or hey, I want to be part of this. And most people actually said they wanted to be part of this. So we incorporated the company, got a small team together, and then said, everybody who would like to join the company and work in exchange for stock options in the company, please apply. We got around 200 applications, got roughly 100 engineers, and started working on the feasibility study. We finished the feasibility study at the end of 2014, and today the company is more than 800 people that are working mostly in still in exchange for stock options, and we have roughly, I think, around 40 companies from all around the world, and a lot of them are leader in the field.
That's an innovative way to run a company. It's very different from the traditional way of running a business. And it's happening so quickly, I really didn't expect it to be from 2 weeks later, okay, we started doing this. Usually the incubation process takes a little bit longer. Have you found any challenges with moving so quickly?
So, you know, again, I think that, I mean, it's 3 years. I don't feel like it's that quickly. the technology is already there. So we did our tests over the last couple of years, and now it's, you know, you need to put it all together into one big system so you can optimize the system, optimize boarding, optimize capsule handling. I think it's also important to go fairly fast because you're working with people, you want to get them excited. If you hear about something 3 years ago and then you hear about it again 3 years later, you might not get that excited about it, but at the end, we talk about Hyperloop because it's a movement you hear about constantly. It's always out there, so it's unstoppable. And I think that's very important, and it's also important to show that you can do progress. So it has been three very hard years, and you know, a lot of miles in the airplane, and traveling around the world, and meeting with world leaders, and you know, doing collaborations and getting people together. But you know, I think really the way we are building the company helps us to, because we get people that have those skill sets already. We don't have to build this again.
Do you think that the meeting people, the networking, the making the connections has really made this a success?
I think that's always the part, right? So when you have an idea and it's just you and you keep the idea for yourself, it's probably very likely never going to happen. So you need to get out, you need to confront yourself with people, you need to get their ideas and ideally get them to help you, you know, to move it forward. So yes, I mean, I think it's crucial, but I think it's crucial for any company that's out there to be around and, you know, to share the ideas and grow. And, you know, every day you're changing a little bit. So you're adjusting where your company is going when you have a startup company.
That's really good advice to give to a lot of the people that are here at KAUS. We have a lot of innovators, and I think you've already met a couple of them here. And they are always looking for, we have great ideas, how do we get them out there? And that is great advice that you just gave.
Yeah, I mean, I think most people are really afraid of sharing their ideas, right? They think that someone else might steal them. But when you realize that you're not the first person that had that idea, because there were at least another, I don't know, four or five. I mean, I've never had an idea where I was the only one having it. Even so, I thought so. Maybe then when, you know, I launched, I found out that there were other people working or trying to do exactly the same thing. The difference lies in the execution. So, you know, it's not the first idea, it's a thousand ideas that follow. So if you share it, if you talk with people and you confront and you get better ideas and you understand where to go and you can figure out where to make a difference, that's really, you know, what brings you to success. And I think the biggest advice or the biggest thing that I've learned is really asking for help. I think a lot of people just don't ever ask for help. So when you meet someone and you explain what you do or what you want to do, and they say, this is amazing, you should go out and you should, the next thing you say should be, hey, why don't you help me? You would be surprised how often they actually be like, yeah, of course, how can I help you? You know, how can I be part of this? So, you know, a lot of times it's people are afraid of sharing, people are afraid of even sharing part of the company, you know, so our model where everybody earns their participation in the company, I think, works amazingly. So they're all part of it, and they're all going into the right direction.
That's good. We're going to take some questions from the audience now. Oh, go ahead.
Thank you. And firstly, thank you for your sharing with us. And my question is, considering the cost and safety and business mode, maybe, how do you see the advantages Hyperloop have comparing with airplane?
Okay, so first of all, we are cheaper than an airplane in cost per kilometer per seat. We're roughly, I think, a third of an A380, for example. But I think it's more about, I mean, an airplane works well on longer distances, right? So when we talk about shorter distances, something that takes you in an airplane maybe 45 minutes, an hour, you lose a lot of time. So you have to get to the airport, you have to be there an hour before, you have to go through a security screening, then you depend on weather. With a Hyperloop, it's just like it's smaller capsules, you have 30 people, departure can be in peak times every 40 seconds, and you'll be there in, let's say, 36 minutes, if it's, for example, Los Angeles to San Francisco. The cost is, the operational cost is cheaper because of the fact that we're using alternative energy. So there's a lot of advantages, and we work together with some of the airlines, for example, that look at us as the perfect solution for these shorter ranges, right? So that's, air travel will not go away. It will stay for longer tracks.
I have a question. When you're talking about building a tube that has to have a near vacuum in order for the Hyperloop to work, and you're going over hundreds of kilometers, how do you protect against earthquakes?
So actually, you're able to protect much better against earthquakes than if you are directly on the ground, on a high-speed train, for example. We are on pylons, so we can integrate the latest earthquake technology and be able to stabilize the system as much as possible. It obviously depends where you are. I mean, if the epicenter is right there where you're going over at the moment you're passing at the speed of sound, it's difficult, right? But there is now new technology that allows you to be warned a couple seconds before. There's a lot of technology advancements in earthquakes, and the system is definitely much safer than anything else you would have directly on the ground. So you can protect against it.
How flexible is it in going into turns, left and right? It's called the hyperloop. Can it go into loops at the speed of sound?
Well, no. I mean, at the speed of sound, not very flexible. Because when you go that fast, you know, the lateral G forces would be very strong. But it doesn't have to go that fast. So when you have, when you plan the route, you of course plan the route that's the straightest possible. If you have to have curves in any directions, you have to slow down.
Any good questions from our viewing audience from watching on Facebook?
Yes, we have one. Is there such a thing as an ideal startup, or should the creation of every startup be approached in a unique, bespoke way?
Wow, okay.
Tough one, huh?
An ideal startup. I mean, for me, an ideal startup is a venture where you're passionate about what you're doing, you're solving a problem that you personally have. I think those are the most important parts. A lot of people just do companies or just do startups to try to make money, to try to make fast money. When you work on something that you have experienced yourself and you're knowing you're addressing something that's important for you, then you will be successful. And especially if you figure out something that's in a fairly large market. So I think that at the end, being successful is more depending on the entrepreneur and on being persistent than anything else. So there's, like, my favorite quote from Rocky is actually, it's not about how hard you hit, it's about how hard you can get hit. And that's how it is. I mean, all the entrepreneurs that I've met, they all struggled. They all went through really hard times because it is really, really hard. People, when they see success, it looks amazing, but the work that's behind and the issues that came before, and you know, that's really shows if you want to do this and if you want to make this happen. So so that in an ideal thing, it is something that you really, really love doing.
Thank you so much. You've compared Hyperloop with planes, but how we can compare it with high-speed trains? This is like a bit different, but very close to Hyperloop idea.
Yeah, I mean, you know, for me, it's a different technology at the end, right? It's just it's an iteration. So at the end, if you would take a train, if you would take a high-speed train, and you would put them into a very large tube, and you would take the air out, now this train could go much faster with much less energy. All we're doing is basically just optimizing the system, making it cheaper to build, making it more efficient. That's basically it. So it's a technology iteration. As I said earlier, the biggest issue, when I looked at the feasibility of the Hyperloop, the biggest surprise was that we are building all this new infrastructure that's basically really built on old concepts. It doesn't make sense. It loses money all the time. So, I mean, as an entrepreneur, I would not do something that doesn't make money.
And yes, they're finding excuses because it's great for the economy, but at the end, you know, rather than spending $68 billion, I think that we can, if we spend, let's say, $1 billion on researching something new, we can build something better. And that's kind of what we are doing. So really figuring out how can we do this better. We're in 2017. There hasn't been really any innovation in public transportation, in trains and metros. Everyone who's coming out of the digital world or the technology world knows that you can do things better. I mean, if you have ever been to San Francisco and you have taken the BART and you bought a ticket, I mean, for San Francisco, it's incredible how bad the user experience design of the ticketing machine is, because I can figure out how to buy a ticket there. It's just because they're basically paid by the government. They're paid with tax money. But they started out, I mean, rail was done by entrepreneurs and those who are very successful entrepreneurs, and we can do that again. There's a lot of business models that we can apply. There's a lot of technologies that we can use to make this more efficient and better. So, you know, I don't think it's necessarily a comparison, it's more an iteration, right? It's trying to make it better and solve these problems.
We have one more question here from Luca online, and it's about the dynamics of the people that you hire as a young startup. Every person in a young startup has a huge impact. And if you make a bad choice in hiring the wrong person, it can really ruin the dynamics of the team. So what are the key things that you look for when you're hiring your first core group of employees?
All right, so I understand the struggle, and I've always had the same. It's very difficult to hire anybody. And I think our model is actually, I mean, we have an advantage there, because most people are working in exchange for stock options. So when we started to hire, we of course took the ones that already were working for us, that were working for stock options, that were really passionate about what they're doing, and we were seeing them being up at night and really trying to make this happen, so that we could just say, okay, well, now we move you full time. You don't need to do your job anymore. We're paying you. So, you know, you really find the best people there. You know them already. That's a big advantage. And a lot of times I've met people that I really, really liked, but they were not okay with just joining for stock options. They wanted to have salaries, and at the end we didn't take them. And I must say that I was always happy. I think that we did the right decision. I think that at the end we found someone better who was more motivated. I mean, as a CEO of a startup company, I think it's the most amazing feeling to know that if you run out of money tomorrow, your team will still show up. And that makes a huge difference, right? If everybody really wants to make this happen. So that's what you have to look for, I think, mostly. And of course, they need to fit in. But yeah, hiring, that's probably a startup by itself. I mean, really figuring out how to, you know, get the right people involved. And we're doing a lot of that. We're trying to figure out how they can all fit together. But for me, it was really mostly, I don't want to have employees. I want to have people that are part of this venture. So when all the other companies I've done as a CEO a lot of times, I always felt like I was the one pulling the wagon, and my employees were on the back on top of the wagon, and I had to pull them, and I had to make sure that we're moving forward. This is the first time that I really feel like there's other people pushing the wagon from the back. And even if I hold back and if I'm down, because it happens, right? It's a cycle. One day you feel like you're the most amazing person ever and you're going to be successful, and the next day you're like, this is never going to work. But there's people pushing from the back, and I can't even stop. I just need to move forward. They're waiting for me. They're bothering me. You know, we need to do this. We need to get this. We need to. So when you find those people, that's very valuable.
We have time for one more question. Well, I think this was excellent. Thank you so much for joining us today. Dirk will be our keynote speaker tonight at KAUST at 5 o'clock, so you can see him in the auditorium. And thank you very much.
Thank you.